This text is Borough Genius by Victor Villaseñor. Today we are reading pages 67 through 83, which is pages 32 through 40 in our text PDF.
Looking back, I now remember that it was just about the same time when a red-headed kid with lots of freckles came to our school.
And this kid spoke an English that was so much worse than all of us Mexican kids said we thought. Goody, goody! Somebody else besides us, los Mexicanos, is now going to get slapped across the face and called stupid. But boy, were we wrong. Our teacher didn't hit this new boy, knocking the freckles off his face. No. She gave him compliments and always told him how smart he was. Finally, we vatos guys got all together and went to our teacher to complain. Look, we said to her, how come you don't hit him in the head and call him names like you call us? His English is way worse than ours. He's a foreigner. He isn't a foreigner, our teacher said to us. You twerps are the foreigners. He's from Boston, and Boston is back east, and he is a very important historical part of the United States. Well, we didn't believe her. How could he be from the United States, talking as funny as he did? Like the word car, he said, ka-ah, sounding like a crow talking into the wind. His name was Howard, but by the way he said it, none of us were able to figure out what his name was for the first few days. Still, I liked him. So one day, I tackled him out on the playground and we started wrestling on the grass. He was strong and I was strong. So we were having ourselves a real fun time, rolling around, hitting each other, when a bunch of my vato amigos came up and said, no te dejes, pégale. Don't let him get you, hit him. Hearing this, Howard stopped wrestling and he stared at me with big eyes. Are you Mexican? He said. I quickly translated what he said in Bostonian English and Californian English and said, yeah, sure, I'm Mexicano. Well, this boy who'd just been wrestling me with so much confidence and power now let out a scream of sheer terror, scaring the living hell out of me, saying, you got a knife! And I thought he said that he had a knife, so I turned still and started running as fast as I could to get away from him. But then as I ran, I figured out what he said and turned around and saw he was running in the opposite direction. I stopped and started after him, catching him at the end of the playground where he was all sweaty and scared and crying to beat hell. Look, Howard, I said. I don't got a knife. Oh, yes you do, he yelled between sobbing cries. No, I don't, I said. Yes you do, he yelled again, his eyes flowing with tears. My parents told me that Mexicans always have knives. They do? I didn't know that. I'll bring one tomorrow, I said. The bell rang, and we walked back to the classrooms. Despite this, we really liked each other, and the next day, I brought a little rusty pocket knife to school that I couldn't get open. At recess, I showed it to Howard and asked him if he'd like to come to the ranch and go bow and arrow hunting with me or learn how to wreck a bucking pig. I'd like to, he said, but I can't even be around you anymore. Why not, I said. Because I had a talk with my parents last night, he said. And they explained to me that I can't be around Mexicans because they're bad, dirty people, and you can't trust them. Oh, I didn't know that, I said, feeling my whole chest tighten. I'm sorry. And saying this, I didn't know what to do, because I really liked Howard a lot, so I didn't want him getting in trouble for being around bad, dirty people. I turned and walked away feeling terrible. I'd never known Mexicans were bad, dirty people, and you couldn't trust them. I just thought we were stupid people. Closer to the animals, and not as smart as white people, as the playground teacher kept explaining to us. All the rest of the day, I hung around with my vatos amigos so I couldn't offend anyone else, feeling really awful. And when my amigos asked me what was wrong, I didn't want to tell them what I just found out about us. So I kept still, with tears running down my face. That afternoon, when I got home to our ranch, something happened to me that I would never forget for the rest of my life. I could now see very clearly that what Howard had told me about us, los Mexicanos, being bad, dirty people, was absolutely true. Our horse corrals were full of manure, and there were flies by the zillions of the milking barn, and our cars and trucks and tractors were covered with dirt and mud. The night at the dinner table, I felt like I was sitting down to eat with people I'd never really seen before. My mother, who I'd always thought was so beautiful, I could now clearly see that she wasn't. Her brown skin was the color of dirt, her dark eyes were too large, and her hair was black, her hips were too big. Also, she was chubby, with large breasts, and looked disgusting. The way she kept letting my baby sister Linda hang all over her, nursing all the time. And my father, my God, he had a big head with curly black hair and a real thick neck like a bull. And he was so loud. He ate with his fingers, using his tortilla scoop to scoop the food in his mouth, and he chewed with his mouth open, laughing and telling story after story, showing the food that he was chewing. I'd never realized it before, but my father wiped his hands off on the tablecloth, pulling more and more of the tablecloth towards himself as the meal progressed. We all had to move our chairs down to the table towards him as we ate, if we wished to stay with our plates. And my sister Densha and brother Joseph, who had always thought were good-looking too, I could now see that they were also chubby, dirty Mexicans, just like my parents. I remember well that I wanted to cry. I'd never known any of this about mi familia. You were really dirty, bad, ugly people and liars too? Just as the playground teacher kept telling us? Because she was right. We did lie to her when we denied that we hadn't been speaking Spanish on the playground. The truth was that we still spoke Spanish every chance we got. And why? Because simply, it felt good to hear in the sound of the language with which our mothers had rocked us to sleep when we'd been little. I finally felt so sick, sitting at the table with these ugly, dirty, bad people, mi familia, that I got up and went to the bathroom to get away from them. Then in the bathroom, I'll never forget, I puked in the toilet, and then stood on my little stool so I could wash my mouth in the sink. And this is a day when I saw me in the mirror that, oh my good Lord, I too was Mexican and ugly. I had big teeth, a wide face with high cheekbones, and my skin was also a dirty brown color. Oh my Lord God, Papito, I screamed. Why did you let me be born a Mexican? That night, I woke screaming and my mother had to come to my room several times to help me rock me back to sleep. And when she'd asked me what was the matter, what could I tell her? I didn't want my parents finding out that we were bad, dirty people and couldn't be trusted. I loved them. I really did. And so I didn't want to hurt them with all these awful truths that I was learning about us at school. After all, the school was way bigger than our home, had a huge flag at the entrance of the school grounds, and so they knew that they were talking about. Not my papa and mama. Poor fools. The very next day, I don't exactly know why, but I took two pocket knives to school. I guess I figured that, hell, since I was a no-good, dirty, bad Mexican anyways, I might as well carry two knives, not just one, so I could then be the baddest, dirtiest Mexican of all. I'd found the first little knife in a drawer in the tractor shed. The second knife I took from my dad's personal toolbox, and the second one had a much larger knife my dad used for castrating the pigs and calves on our ranch. And so it was razor sharp, and you had to be real careful of opening it, or you could cut yourself real bad. At school, I showed the Vato guys my two knives, telling them how I'd been told that Mexicans always carry knives, so I was going to carry two. But that's not true, said Blackbird, one of the Vatos. In my family, we carry guns, not knives. This guy's nickname was Blackbird because he was the darkest vato among us. Yeah, said the screwdriver. He was the skinniest guy in our group. My family has pistols and rifles, too, not just knives. So I say we should also bring guns to school to protect ourselves from all these pinche teachers. This made sense to all of us. Why limit ourselves to just knives? We should bring guns to school, too. And so there, we were talking, really enjoying ourselves, and getting to feel a whole lot better, when suddenly, out of nowhere, there was that big, old, muscular woman, playground teacher at outside, yelling, "No Spanish," she screamed, "English only." Then she saw the knife that I was trying to open, and she screamed out again, "Oh, a knife! I told him, that this was going to happen. I was going to catch you dirty little spicks with knives one day, and now I have." She was so happy that she was beaming. Quickly, she took the little knife from me I hadn't been able to open, and she grabbed me by the ear, yanked me off to the ground, and had me high-stepping it on my toes to the principal's office. The good knife, the sharp one that my dad had used for castrating, Ramon had snatched from me when she'd first come up, and he hid it. In the principal's office, Galo Galina, the teacher, as we nicknamed her, the rooster hen, yelled and yelled, singing how she'd risked her life, but still she'd done her job and disarmed me when I was getting a knife with the other dirty Mexican kid. A knife fight, I said? There was no fight. You're lying. Are you calling me a liar? Yes, but in English, I said quickly. All in English, I added proudly.
Instead of me getting a reward for my brilliant ability to say all this in English, she now slapped me across the face so hard that I was knocked off my feet. Then the principal came around from behind his big desk, and I thought he was going to help me up and defend me from this crazy lookout woman, but he only started hitting on me too, saying that he had no live fights at his school. Dodging their blows, I began screaming, "But I did in English only! Don't you see, pendejos? I did English only!" This was when I got a glimpse of my vatos amigos. They were outside the principal's window, standing on a bench, waving and laughing. That was the day that I finally accepted by the vatos in their little club of Bosol Town, the Mexican barrio in Oceanside, just up the hill from the pier and the east of the high school. I'd finally turned out not to be such a little kindergarten boy born in gravy, after all. My parents were called to the school. They were told how I and a few other Mexican kids were the main troublemakers of the whole kindergarten, and now we'd started a gang, and that I brought a knife to school and got into a knife fight. My mother was beside herself with shock, but my father, on the other hand, seeing the little rusty knife, just grinned and winked at me. "Does it open?" he asked the principal. "What?" asked the principal. "That little knife, does it open?" "I don't know. I guess it does." "Maybe you better check to see if it opens before you keep on talking and accusing people." The principal tried opening the rusty little knife, but couldn't. "But this isn't the point," said the principal. "Your son brought a knife to school. That's the point." And he went on and on about how bad we Mexicans were, until I thought that my dad was going to come out of his chair and knock the living shit out of the principal. All the way home, my parents kept yelling at each other, trying to figure out what to do with me. I cried and cried. "Lupe," my dad said once we were home, "be smart. Don't let yourself be taken in by that man's bullshit. There was no knife fight. Get it? That knife didn't even open. It would have been soaked in oil for 2 or 3 days to loosen the rust before it can ever be opened." But like he said, that's not the point, Salvador. "What will our son be taking to school next? Guns?" "Yes," I said under my breath. For the next few days, all my parents did was argue about what to do with me. Finally, I couldn't take it anymore, so I decided that I was going to run away from home. I'd never meant to bring this shame to my familia. There was just nothing else left for me to do but run away, was the way I saw it. So Friday after school, I saddled up, got my Red Ryder BB gun, and took off up the railroad track, going towards Vista. I figured that I'd go up the Poza Bonsal and learn to live off the land out by the Pala Indian Reservation, where we had some relatives on my Uncle Archie Freeman's side of the family. Out there in the wilds of the Rezas, our Indian relatives like to call the reservation, I'd live happily and free and be in no trouble to anyone for the rest of my life. I was 5.5 years old, and I'd already done me nearly 3 damn months of schooling, so I figured that I'd just sit about, learn me all that needed to know. "Shut up. Nap time. Keep me still. Stop fidgeting. No bathroom till recess." The only thing that I'd forgotten to tell us when to fart, which was what some of us vatos had started doing after lunch in the back of the classroom. This drove our teacher crazy, especially when we cut loose a real good smelling one. The father-son was just about going down into the ocean way behind me to the west when I came across 2 skinny old trail worn cowboys herding a herd of horses down the railroad tracks. They told me that they'd been driving this herd of stock all the way over from Arizona, and they asked me if I knew a place where they could hole up in some corrals for the night. They were just about 2 wildest-looking old cowboys that I'd ever seen. They had huge hats, almost looking like sombreros, big wild beards, and they were packing sidearms and smelled worse than the 12 roadkill skunks. They told me that when they started out at the border town near Tucson, Arizona, they had 4 other cowboys with them, well over 150 head of wild Mustangs. But within a couple weeks of being on the trail, all 4 of the other good old boys had quit on them, and so they had to sell off some of their stock, lost a few others, and now the 2 of them were down just to 50, and some head of the horses nearly 6 months of being on the trail. I told them my family had a ranch and lots of corrals, but that I couldn't help them because I was, well, running away from home. I never forget how they glanced at each other, grinned, but didn't laugh. When they looked over at my horse, my equipment carefully, they saw that I had a blanket, my BB gun, a lariat,
and my big old toothbrush that was tied to my saddle horn. Well, it seems like you got everything, said the taller one. So where are you headed?
East, I said.
East? He said, laughing. Don't you know that cowboys don't ever go east? They go west. Well, yeah, I know that, I said. But our ranch ends at almost the ocean, so I can't go any further west unless I use a boat. Hearing this, they started laughing so hard that I thought they'd die. Then, the one who was doing all the talking asked me if I could maybe postpone running away for a day or two, and ride home and ask my dad if they could hold up our quarrels for the night. Yeah, sure, I could do that, I said, figuring out what the hell it was a little too late in the day for me to run away anyway. Why are y'all running? I asked. The other one, who hadn't said a word yet, he was shorter and smaller and had a real big blue eye shaped like squirrels. I liked him. He seemed a lot more animal to me than human, which was good, of course, because my grandmother, Doña Guadalupe, had always explained to me that all humans were born with animal spirit to help guide them through their life. And so the humans who realized this would almost seem more animal than human, and this was wonderful. It kept us closer to God. Because, well, of school, I said, with tears suddenly coming to my eyes. I couldn't talk anymore. I was so choked up. I done did the same damn thing, and said Squirrel Eyes, with his two big blue eyes getting even bigger. Then he started scratching himself all over. First the back of the head, then he started on his ribs, scratching wildly. I guess that maybe school had rubbed the wrong way, too. Me too, said the bigger one, who seemed to do all the talking. School, I swear, it's where more wild free spirits than barbed wire or week of Sundays. Hearing this, I felt pretty damn good. And hell, I thought only Mexicans had it bad at school. Putting any young healthy boy or girl in a room, telling them to keep still all the time, is as unnatural as putting a beaver on a dry dock and telling him to forget his river damming yearnings. Continued the talker. Hell, kids need to whip it up and be wild for God's sake. Boy, oh boy, these old guys were really talking my kind of language. Quickly, I turned my old horse Coraline around and started back for home on the railroad tracks. Never in my life have I ever seen the two cowboys like those two old guys. Getting home, I rode my horse past the corrals, right up to our house. Papa, I yelled, dismounting and running to the house through the back porch. There was a whole herd of wild Mustangs headed our way, and the two cowboys herding them wanted to know if they can hold up for the night at our place. Where are they? On the railroad tracks just below the cemetery out by El Camino Road. They'll be here in a little while, Papa.
I see, said my Papa.
Then you already invited them? I turned all red. Well, not really. Well, kind of, I guess. Because I didn't tell them we had lots of quarrels.
Okay.
I'll back your hand this time, mijito, said my father. But in the future, I never want you telling people what we have till you've seen their hand first. Especially with strangers, eh? Understand? You got to always keep your cards up close to your chest. That's a man's power. Capiche?
Yes, I capiche, Papa.
Good. I ran out the back door and got up on the porch railing and remounted my horse Coraline and took off like a jackrabbit with the coyote on his ass. I needed to get back and help those two old boys bring in their herd of wild Mustangs through the first narrow passage in the mudflats. If a man didn't know those flats but know our home, he could end up getting his livestock in a whole lot of trouble. And I knew the country between us and El Camino like I knew the palms of my hands, especially now that we're getting hit on our hands often at school, and we kept needing to check our palms to see if anything had been broken. Yeah, I yelled, riding up so fast to the herd. My dad says you guys can hold up on our place for the night. Quickly, I took over the moving of the stock. Hell, I've been riding the horse since I was 3 years old, and I'd move a lot of cattle and horses in my day. It took no thinking for me to figure out who the lead mare was, so I quickly zeroed out on her and got her going down the safe trail across the mudflats. And the lead mare really knew her stuff. So working with her, I was able to keep those horses together as we came in towards our ranch. My dad was at the corrals to meet us with a bottle of whiskey. I watched my dad's eyes look over the herd of horses real carefully as he handed a big bottle to the two old cowboys. The old-timers each took a swing, wiping their mouths off with the backs of their hands. The taller one, the talker, introduced himself to my dad. He said his name was Jake Evans. Jake told my dad how the night before he'd held up with their herd, just on the other side of Escondido,
which lay about 25 miles east of us, and they'd been allowed to rest their stock for 3 days. Instantly, I could see where this was headed. Jake was now trying to pull a slick one over my dad and turn a one-night stay over into 3 days, but my father didn't fall for it, so I asked where they planned to be tomorrow night. Jake saw it hadn't worked, so he then told my father that they planned on going all the way up to Irene Ranch tomorrow and then work their way into Los Angeles by the end of the week, and where they had a deal to sell their stocks to a movie company that made westerns just a few miles of North Hollywood. Jake then asked if my dad could ride the trail with him the rest of the way, since they'd seen how good a hand I was with horses. I didn't know if they were pulling my leg or not, but I yelled, "Hell yeah, I'm ready, and I'll be saddled at daybreak." My dad and the two men laughed at the past bottle of whiskey around one more time. Our conversation was all in Spanish. Our own ranch hands, who were vaqueros from Mexico, had gathered around, and they too joined the conversation. These two old gringo cowboys spoke their Spanish real good, and looked even more Mexican in their dress than some of our own cowhands. My dad told the two trail-worn old boys that yes, they could keep their herd in our place for the night, and that there would be no change for the hay. They thanked him up and down and offered to pay him with one Mustang, but he refused, saying that we had enough horses already, and that he better hold on to whatever stock they had left. They looked mighty relieved and asked if they could shower too. "Of course," said my dad. "And if you've cleaned yourselves, you can come down to the main house and eat with us if you'd like." Both of the old boys turned all red. "No gracias, señor," said Jake. "We wouldn't rightly know how to behave in front of a casa with women and all. We just make us fire out there in the ground and cook us up some beans." "Look," said my dad, "wash up, come to the house, and if you don't feel comfortable, then just take your plates of carne asada and salsa verde to eat outside. My wife, Lupe, she makes the best damn salsa and tortillas you ever tasted." Hearing this, both cowboys' mouths started watering with wet, drooling saliva. "Okay," said the non-talker. "Then that's how we'll do her." "Good," said my father, taking the bottle of whiskey. "I don't want you boys coming in all tanked up." My father and I walked home carrying the big old bottle of whiskey. "Papa," I said, all excited, "could I really ride with them tomorrow? I'm sure I could help." I wasn't that interested in running away anymore. No. Now I figured out that I had just become a cowboy like these two old-timers. "Mijito," he said, "it looks like fun herding horses, don't it?" "Yeah," I said. "Well, it isn't. You just don't have any ideas what those two poor bastards have gone through." Sure, in the good old days, two real good horsemen could move a herd of horses from here to Kingdom Come and have no real problemas. All they'd have to do is watch out for rattlers, bears, coyotes, rustlers, and know where to find water and grass. But now, in modern times, with highways, towns, and barbed wire everywhere, those two men gotta be half crazy loco to have brought a herd of horses all the way from Tucson, Arizona. "But Papa, if I..." "I've told you 1,000 times, mijito," he said, cutting me off. "There are no buts or ifs in life. If my aunt had balls, she'd be my uncle. And but means that you didn't listen to a damn thing of what the other guy just said. No, mijo, you listen good and understand that, yeah, sure, it looks like fun to you, and it could be fun back in the old days when a man was young, but neither of those old cowboys are young anymore. They're old fools, mijito, trying to hold on to a way of life that doesn't exist anymore. They remind me of some of our own people back in Los Altos de Jalisco, still trying to be charros to the very end, and I can admire them here in my heart for their spirit and horsemanship. But I'm not going to romance what they do here in my head, any more than I'll romance two people getting together and starting a family without having the means or guts to figure out how to make ends meet. Hell, it was almost dark when they pulled up here with their herd of horses. That's not right. A man, mijito, has to have the tantes to get me. The balls to know how and when to change with the changing times. I nodded. I could see that what my dad was trying to say was right. Then it's once again like the little crow and the father crow story, eh, Papa? Exactly, said my dad. Each and every generation needs to add to the knowledge of the past generation, just like the little crow did to his father's. This story of the little crow and the father crow, my dad had been telling me for as long as I could remember. How the father crow taught his little son crow to be careful of two-legged people when they came close and bent over to pick up a rock. But then, the little son crow thought even further ahead and told his dad that maybe they should fly off before a two-legged bent over to pick up a rock.
because maybe the tricky two-legged human already had a rock in his pocket. We can't just hold on to the past with old, foolish hopes, said my dad, and then get bitter and mad because things don't work out or stay the same. What could these two cowboys have done, mijito, if you hadn't come across them? And what would they have done if I hadn't decided to give them free hay? They got no money. You can see that by the shape their stock is in, I nodded. I could see that my father was right. Always remember, added my dad, dime con quién andas y te diré quién eres. Tell me who you talk with, and I'll tell you who you are. Your job is to go to school right now, mijito. And a good man does his job no matter what. Really, papa? No matter what? Even school? Yes, no matter what. Even school. My madre didn't panic and die in the middle of the revolution like my father and leave us kids to starve to death. No, she stayed with us kids, the three that she had left, and kept us alive no matter what. Capiche? I nodded. Good. Then tomorrow I send Thomas out with these two cowboys and get them going, continued my dad. Thomas was our foreman. Maybe the Marines will let him pass through Camp Pendleton. A lot of horses get killed between there and Los Angeles if they aren't careful with traffic. Damn it, they're grown men, mijo, and you can't just be herding horses or cattle up the highways like in the old days anymore. That evening, I didn't even realize the old two cowboys when they came into the house, all washed up and shaved. They were actually maybe even younger than my dad, and I thought they were close to 99 years old. They decided not to take their plates outside to eat and sat right down with us in our big oak table. That night, we heard story after story how they had to fight the rustlers just on the other side of Phoenix. Then, they'd been hit by a hailstorm that had almost knocked them out of their saddles. Then, they had to go around on a long stretch of wild land to avoid the sandhill deserts in the California border so they could keep their herd from dying of thirst. And now they, too, were wiping off their hands on the tablecloth like my dad. In fact, they seemed to just about copy everything that my dad did, figuring, I guess, that these were proper table manners. That night, I got a feeling a lot better about mi familia. I could see good in mi familia once again, without all that stuff from school going off inside my brain. School, in fact, now seemed so far away that I could hardly believe I'd ever go up to that stupid place at all. In the morning, I got up real early, planning to sneak off with the cowboys, whether my dad liked it or not. Hell, I wasn't ever going back to school again. I wanted to live my whole life up on the top of a horse where I could run and leap like Superman himself. The two old cowboys were surprised to see me saddled and ready to go when they rolled out of their bedrolls. They had slept in the hay barn, which was smart, because I figured that's where I have slept too. Are you sure that your dad said you can go to us, asked Jake? Oh yeah, sure, I said, lying, suddenly remembering that this was exactly what they were always telling us at school, that Mexicans did lie. But we got to get going fast, so you can beat the Sunday traffic going to church, I added. Look, said Jake, last night, after you went to bed, we told your dad had we come across you running away from home. You did? I said. Yes, we did. It was the honest thing to do, son. And you should have seen the hurt look on your dad's face, because you see, Mexican kids don't run away from home. White kids, gringo kids, like me and Luke, were the ones who run from home. But Mexicans, they never do that. And you know why they don't? Added Jake in that same soft tone of voice which he always spoke. Because Mexicans are just naturally warm, loving, good people. Really? Mexicans are good people? I said, tears coming to my eyes. You're damn right. Great people. The best. Hell, all the way out from Arizona to California. In every town, they'd be the first one to open up their doors to two cold coots and share their frijoles with us, no matter how poor they were. And that's what we saw around your dinner table last night, too. Good old-fashioned, honest family, hospitality, with lots of love, he added. Big Jade's right, said the other cowboy, talking with his half-wildest, nervous stutter. Last night, she, with the most... It looked like he was about ready to burst open, trying to get the words he wanted to tell. Loving. Damn good homemade cheese and like my life. Luke's right, said Jake. People dream of una familia like yours. Big old long dinner table with plenty of homemade cheese, carne asada, salsa, and fresh lemonade. Son, you got the whole world here. You understand? So you don't let no damn school cause you to run off. You dig in, you see? Keep your powder dry, and don't let no son-of-a-bitch teachers run you off homestead, you hear? I hear, I said, feeling 10 feet tall.
And that morning, I stood shoulder to shoulder on horseback with my father and brother as we waved goodbye to those two old cowboys as they rode off with the herd of horses headed for Los Angeles, then to a place north of Hollywood. Maybe Mexicans weren't bad people after all. So then, maybe it was all right for me to love mi familia. I had tears in my eyes watching these two old guys ride off, herding their stock. You really want to go with them, don't you? Said my dad. Yeah, I said. Well then, go on, said our dad. You and your brother go with them, and Thomas as far as Camp Pendleton, then come home. My brother Joseph and I were off in a flash, slapping leather like we are charros de Jalisco.